My name's Timothy West, and this is my wife, Prunella Scales.
We are a pair of actors of a certain vintage.
Basil?
All the world's a stage, and in our time we both played many parts, but as we head towards the final curtain call, there are still a couple of parts we like returning to.
The captain.
Cast off, please.
Aye, sir.
And his mate. Prue's memory is not what it was.
Oh, my darling, I'm so sorry. I didn't cast you off.
It's true. Some days I don't know whether it's Monday or Lewisham. Yeah.
But exploring canals and waterways is something we can still share.
Something we both love.
And together, we've travelled up and down Great Britain and across Europe.
So now it's time to head for waterways anew.
We're setting sail on a grand voyage along one of the world's most historic waterways.
How does she feel?
It's tough. It's a big boat, but it's working.
The River Nile, the vital artery of an ancient civilization that has entranced me all my life.
Here I am sailing up the Nile in a fully rigged ship. It's amazing.
Wow! Look at that!
Magic.
Recreating a route that Cleopatra once sailed, we'll travel 150 miles from the temples at Luxor to the legendary source of the Nile.
Very colourful, isn't it?
It is.
We'll discover how the world's first canals were used in building the temples of ancient Egypt.
It's massive!
Apparently, it's so big that it could contain St. Paul's Cathedral and St. Peter's in Rome.
For millennia, the Nile has brought fertility to a barren land.
Do you want some more? Yeah, go on.
On this river of life, we feel young again.
I'm rather enjoying it. Can you give me another toke?
Oh, yeah, please. This one, Egyptian Viagra.
At 15 minutes, like a horse. Everything right. Is okay.
And we'll make the most of every moment spent together on this beautiful, timeless waterway.
Not a bad view, is it?
Somewhere to watch the world go by.
Age cannot wither her, nor custom stale her infinite variety. As our last canal journey ended, we thought the moment might have come to call time on our adventures.
Since then, we've not wandered far from Wandsworth.
Not a bad view, is it?
Someone to watch the world go by, I suppose. No place like home. What happens next?
What do you mean?
Well, you're the travel freak. There must be a few more places you're anxious to see.
Is that what you really want?
Yes, it is.
Well, the barge she sat in, like a burnished throne, burned on the water. The poop was beaten gold. Purple the sails, and so perfumed that the winds were lovesick with them.
Antony and Cleopatra. Mm. Do you want us to go to Egypt?
Well, I thought we might. You've never played Cleopatra, have you?
Mm. No, not yet.
Well, now's your chance.
It's time to pack our bags and head for Egypt, to a riverside city that lies 400 miles south of Cairo.
The Nile, the river that helped create a civilization, its waters transforming arid banks into fertile fields. Along its length, ships sailed, laden with everything the ancient kingdom of Egypt required, from grains to spices and the stones that built the temples.
Once worshipped as a god, the Nile held a balance between famine and plenty, life and death.
Waiting for us on the riverbank is our sailing barge, a type that has navigated these waters since the days of the pharaohs.
Well, you ask for a vessel fit for an Egyptian queen?
Yes, with a poop of beaten gold and perfumed sails of purple.
Yeah.
They're red and white.
Well, Dahabeah means Golden One in Arabic. Hello.
Hello, welcome.
We're greeted by her skipper, Mandur, and our host, Enrique.
Hello. Welcome to our home.
It's a pleasure to have you, ma'am. I'm certain you'll have an enjoyable trip.
Yeah.
It's a bit bigger than the boat we're used to.
Well, mm-hmm. You'll manage.
Wonderful.
Based on a design that's at least 2,000 years old, a vessel like this is said to have been the royal barge of Cleopatra. And during the 19th century, the Dahabeah became the vessel of choice for well-heeled European tourists who liked to travel in style.
Pretty luxurious, isn't it?
You could say that.
Quite a break from darkest Wandsworth, isn't it?
Quite a break.
Alalla Arab, hell.
With her crew of 12 and two 70-foot sails, she's certainly a far cry from our usual narrowboat. But these flat-bottomed vessels are perfectly adapted to a river whose shifting sandbanks are an ever-present danger. Skipper Memdur is teaching me how to handle her.
More pulling. Pull. Yeah.
Yeah, she's coming around. Wind is just picking up a bit, isn't it? So
if you pull like this side, so you will make the sail work.
Yeah.
It is different.
It is different, and it takes a little while to really realize that you're actually in control.
Yeah.
It's a great privilege to feel that you're in charge of such a remarkable vessel.
I've always been in love with sailing since I was a little girl and I read Swallows and Amazons, but I'm in my 80s, although I don't admit to that in public. I get away with 67 if I'm lucky, and here I am sailing up the Nile in a fully rigged ship. It's amazing.
We're following the voyage that Cleopatra is said to have made 2,000 years ago. Starting just north of Luxor, we're embarking on a 150-mile journey.
We'll see fertile fields, explore a sacred quarry, and visit ancient temples.
Arriving at the old trading port of Aswan, we'll visit a Nubian village.
Then end our voyage at the legendary source of the Nile.
I haven't got my land legs yet. Good morning.
Our first stop is a place I'm fascinated by. Karnak. Founded 4,000 years ago, the temple is the largest ancient religious site in the world. And was always closely connected with the waterway that runs beside it.
It's massive.
Yes. Apparently, it's so big that it could contain St. Paul's Cathedral and St. Peter's in Rome.
Mm. We're in the land of the giants.
Yeah. Apparently, the tops of the pillars are meant to represent papyrus flowers. And the ground is the River Nile. So you can swim through the temple.
Karnak's links with the River Nile were both spiritual and practical. Temple historian El Tayyab explains how in the old days, everything and everybody important arrived by boat.
So this is the main quay of Karnak Temples, which used by the fairs.
This was once a waterfront.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed. Now, the Nile changed its location to the west, about 200 meters. During the fairs, we had a canal here, connect between the harbor, the quay, to the Nile.
Of course, canals weren't a new thing, were they? They'd been built hundreds of years before that.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Actually, the ancient Egyptians, they were pioneers to make this kind of canals and streams, locks.
Yes.
I'm used to canals carrying coal and the like. But once a year, the canal at Karnak carried a deity from the temple to the Nile as part of god Amun's conjugal visit to his wife, Mut.
So here we can see the main boat of this procession.
Al-Tayeb has brought us to engravings that recall the festival of Opet.
What was the religious purpose of the festival?
We think the religious purpose of this festival was celebrating of the sexual intercourse between the great god Amun-Ra and his consort, the great goddess Mut. He used to visit his wife every year for this month.
So he only visited his wife for intercourse once a year?
Yes, indeed.
Yes, but every night for 28 days.
Oh, that's enough, yes.
Yeah.
As well as the ceremonies, waterways played another vital role in the story of Karnak. Every stone used to build the temple, from the smallest to the very largest, was transported here by water.
This was built by the female pharaoh Hatshepsut.
She liked her obelisks big, didn't she?
Oh, yes. It's about 100 feet high and weighs about 350 tons.
How on earth did they get it here?
It's a single piece of granite.
Yeah.
And came from a quarry in Aswan, where we're going.
Yeah.
Nearly 150 miles from here. The Roman writer Pliny says that they built barges underneath it, dug a canal, and then when the Nile flooded, just sailed it all the way to Karnak.
And now it's 30 foot higher than the moon.
Yes. Well, it shows what you can do with a canal boat.
Leaving the temple, we take a short trip up the river to the town of Luxor and our digs for the night.
Up you go, yes.
Magic.
The Winter Palace was built in 1907, back when Luxor was a fashionable holiday destination for tourists who were cruising up the Nile on the first ever Thomas Cook steamers. And we've been given a rather special room.
Wow! Oh. Look at that!
Amazing!
Hey! The Valley of the Kings. That's where, in 1922, Lord Carnarvon and Carter discovered King Tutankhamun's tomb.
Ever since my Egypt-obsessed schoolmistress introduced the class to Tutankhamun, I've been captivated by the tale. So I'm thrilled to be staying in the very suite slept in by archaeologist Howard Carter.
I heard a story that Carter was so keen to show his discovery to the world press that he got hold of the mummy of Tutankhamun, but he had nowhere to store the mummy for a few days. So while he waited, he put it in the bath. Fancy a bath tonight?
I think I'd rather have a shower.
The ancient Egyptians believed the Nile was the dividing line between death and life, night and day. And when the sun rises tomorrow, we'll continue our voyage along this sacred river.
Not a bad view, is it?
Somewhere to watch the world go by.
We've left the familiar confines of city life to embark upon an epic journey along the River Nile.
Sailing from the historic city of Luxor to the old river trading port of Aswan, we are following the voyage Queen Cleopatra is said to have made over 2,000 years ago.
I've only ever sailed a dinghy before.
It may be a far cry from crewing on a narrowboat, but I'm loving every moment.
Got to be strong.
Yes, you do.
It's not too late to learn something new for either of us.
It is heavy, yeah?
It is heavy, but it's a big rudder.
It's the time of harvest along the Nile, and today our dahabiya will carry us south into the Nile Valley's most fertile region. We'll then navigate the river's narrowest stretch to a sacred quarry, birthplace of the greatest temples of ancient Egypt.
Thanks to Captain Memdur and our host Enrique, we're enjoying the same luxurious form of travel that was enjoyed by ancient Egyptian nobility.
Enrique, the dahabiya has been traditionally the perfect form of transport on the Nile for thousands of years, hasn't it?
Yes, since the pharaonic period.
Yeah.
They found models of them in the burials.
During the 18th and 19th century, they were the vessel of choice for wealthy travelers, including the engineer Brunel and Florence Nightingale.
People would take the trips for 3 months.
Yeah.
Or a year. They would go all the way to the Sudanese border.
Yeah.
And then come back. So it was quite a long trip.
A long trip. When the steamers came along, Thomas Cook's steamers, did that have a bad effect on the dahabiyas?
Yes. When the steamboat came in, the dahabiyas began to die out, except for a few that were in private hands. Mm.
It seemed as if an iconic vessel that had sailed these waters for thousands of years might disappear forever. But in 1997, Enrique and Memdur brought the dahabiyas back to the Nile.
And we thought that it would be wonderful for people to be able to experience sailing on the Nile again the way that pharaohs did.
Quite right.
Egypt is the gift of the Nile, wrote Herodotus 2,500 years ago. And for millennia, its annual floods transformed the arid desert into fertile fields that sustained a civilization. Today, dams control the flow of the river, but the rich harvests continue.
Once fully loaded, the camels are walked down to the Nile and the waiting barge.
You can see the camels approaching.
Yes,
with the sugarcane.
Yes.
On their back. It is the way that has been done since time immemorial.
Yes.
They look so proud, don't they? And they're doing such an enormous job of work. It must weigh an awful lot, doesn't it?
It is very heavy.
Yeah.
I would say that it's 200 to 300 kilos on their back.
Oh, Tim, they're going to knock us over with this.
No, they won't. No, they won't. They'll be all right.
Hello, camel. Hello, lovely. Would you like a bit of sugar cane?
You're in the right job, aren't you? If you like sugar so much. That's 11, please.
Do you want some more?
I think he probably does, yes. Yeah.
Ancient Egypt was known as the breadbasket of the world, and ships laden with grain plied the Nile. Today, the major crop is sugar, and the ships have engines.
Well done!
Hey!
But it seems not much else has changed.
Would you like to be a captain of a barge on the Nile?
Perhaps not that one. In theory, yes, very much. Bon voyage!
That's Ahmed here.
If I were to be a Nile captain, I'd want to be skippering one of these beautiful vessels.
Good board?
Yes.
Good? Yeah. All right. Good.
That's about right.
How does she feel?
Well, it's tough. It's a big boat, but it's working.
The ancient Egyptians called the Nile the River of Life for a good reason. Not only did it provide the food they ate, but it carried the very building blocks of their civilization.
We're at Gebel Silsila, which is a quarry. Not just any old quarry, it's a place where they cut the enormous stones which were going to build the pyramids and the temples.
Amazing.
From at least 1800 years before the birth of Christ, stones were hewn from these sandstone rocks and transported by river all over the kingdom.
Ahmed, hello.
Hello, my friend.
Very good to meet you.
How are you?
This quarry has been still and silent for centuries. But according to archaeologist Ahmed Al-Sayed, it was once a place of blood, sweat and tears.
We have a document from the time of Ramses II, about 1300 BC, that he used about 3,000 workers to cut the stone for his Ramsium temple on the West Bank. Yes. Just for one temple, 3,000 workers.
So it was a very complex organization.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, my friends, now we're gonna see the dock which used it to transfer the block from here.
And once they'd cut their giant block of stone, that was when the real fun started.
That was not easy to move it to a different place. So we have a ramp, you know, to the River Nile. First, imagine that we have a sledge here. Mm-hmm. You know, this sledge,
yes.
Gonna put the rock.
Threaded through these islets were ropes used to try and control the block's descent to the river.
Imagine, but how many animals, how many people begin to pull it or push it, and then step by step, we're moving directly to where, to there.
Incredible. Some of the stones from here were transported in solid blocks, weighing over 50 tons each.
They used very big boats.
Well, they must have been enormous.
Yeah, some of those boats, it's more than 20 meters. If you look at Karnak Temple, its rock come from here, from this area. We have 28 temples there. All of them come from Jabal al-Silsila. So they call that Jabal al-Silsila is the mother of the temples. The River Nile itself give us the life, give us the transport, give us the civilization. That was the source of our life.
Countless lives have been carried upon these sacred waters for generation after generation. Now, in a small way, we too feel part of its endless story. Another two people drifting on the River of Life.
How long have you been sailing?
Yes, from 10 years ago, when my age 18.
Well, when I was a little girl, I wanted to be a sailor.
Yeah.
So you've got the perfect job as far as I'm concerned.
Yes, it's perfect. No, also now you can be a sailor also. So.
Can I?
Yeah, I can teach you. Yeah.
Yes,
everything.
Please.
Yeah.
Yes, right,
yeah,
okay.
Right, yeah.
We've done a number of these trips, but neither of us getting any younger. Maybe we ought to stop. Maybe it's not fair to be taking Prue on a journey like this in her state of mental health. And then I thought, well, why not?
Have you got any songs of the sailors of the Nile?
Yes, we
All
have
right.
song, yeah.
Teach me one.
Yeah. Aya Lisa.
Aya Lisa.
Rayis Gerari.
Aya Lisa.
We met the Shara.
Aya Lisa.
We afraid the Shara'u.
Aya Lisa.
Of El Bahri
Ayib. I don't know what you're saying there.
Yeah,
I mean, it might be saying lots of rude things.
I mean, look at her now. She's animated, she's interested, and she's enjoying it. And she's having a great time. Gosh, who would not in this situation?
Shall I teach you an English thing, Shanti?
Yes.
What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor? Early in the morning. The chorus goes, okay. Way, hey, and up she rises. Way, hey, and up she rises. Way, hey, and up she rises. Early in the morning.
On a 150-mile voyage up the Nile aboard a dahabiyah, vessels that have sailed these waters since the age of the pharaohs.
With Prue's condition slowly but surely deteriorating, we had our doubts about coming. It was a difficult decision we both had to make.
Well, I certainly wouldn't let him go on his own. I'd have to come with him, not only to keep an eye on my husband, but also because all the journeys I've done with him have opened doors for me and given me new and thrilling experiences.
We're heading for a temple dedicated to a reptilian god. And from there, we go on to a city that marked the southernmost limit of ancient Egypt.
Where are we heading for, Tim?
The home of the crocodile. The Temple of Khammamu.
I thought you said there weren't any crocodiles on the Nile.
Well, apparently about 200 people a year are eaten by crocodiles.
Oh.
But of course that's mostly on the Upper Nile, beyond the dam.
Not where we're going?
No, no. However, we're going to meet a crocodile god, Sobek.
Oh. Is that safe?
Oh, I think so.
Today, they're a rare sight. But once this stretch was infested with crocs, up to 20 feet long, they'd attack any creature that crossed their path.
The ancient Egyptians both feared and admired the crocodile, explains temple director Abdul Monaim Said.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Tem. Good morning, Prue. Welcome.
Magnificent.
As we can see here, Sobek, the crocodile god, he represented power and the fertility for ancient Egyptians. His name originally means the one who causes women to be pregnant.
Right.
Right.
That's why, please, Prue, I recommend you to be far from him as much as you can.
Yes.
Otherwise, it will be very dangerous for you.
Fortunately, there are no live crocs on the premises today, but that wasn't always the case.
As we can see, Tim and Prue here, a very big and massive well, which was used to keep the live crocodiles.
Oh.
And how many would there have been there?
74 ones for every year, from which they could choose just one. To be the god Sobek, the local god of Khammamu Temple.
So what happened to the chosen crocodile?
Sent it to a small place behind the temple, which was used as a hospital to be mummified.
Oh, poor things. To swim around waiting to be mummified.
Well, it was a bit of an honor to be chosen.
No, but they didn't know that, did they?
Thousands of years later, some of the lucky or unlucky winners of the annual Sobek competition are still here.
2,600 years of Sobeks.
Oh,
he's enormous, isn't he?
The teeth.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you remember the rhyme from Alice? How doth the little crocodile
improve his shining tail and pours the waters of the Nile from every golden scale. How cheerfully he seems to grin.
How neatly spread his claws.
And welcomes little fishes in with gently smiling jaws. I wouldn't like to be a little fish in front of that lot,
would you? Not much.
No. Well, in 2,600 years, They still, like, look quite fierce, don't they?
Yes.
Hello.
Don't get too close. Apart from everything else, you might get pregnant. Our next port of call is the historic city of Aswan.
Good. Okay.
It was once a border town of ancient Egypt, where Pharaonic peoples mingled with the rest of Africa.
Thank you.
During the 19th and early 20th century, the city's warm climate and dry air drew flocks of rich and ailing Europeans to Aswan to convalesce in its luxurious hotels.
Just the sort of place to attract the wealthy, self-absorbed characters written about by the Queen of Crime. Agatha Christie stayed here at the nearby Cataracts Hotel, and it's where she assembled her fictional guests for their fatal voyage.
Oh, Death on the Nile.
Yeah.
Right.
Hercule Poirot was prattling gently, his expression that of beatific good humour. He wore a white silk suit, carefully pressed, a Panama hat, and carried a highly ornamental fly whisk with a sham amber handle. It enchants me, he was saying. The black rocks of Elephantine and the sun and the little boats on the river. Yes, it is good to be alive. You do not find it so, mademoiselle?
Where am I?
There.
All right. It's all right, I suppose. I think Aswan's a gloomy sort of place. The hotel's half empty and everyone's about 100.
Yes, I myself have a foot in the grave. But we can still have some fun, you and me, n'est-ce pas?
That bit's not in the book.
Back then, whilst privileged Europeans lay languorously in their hotels, Aswan Souk was alive with traders from all over North Africa.
On sale then was everything from silk and spices to animal skins and elephants' tusks. Meanwhile, at its cafes, Nubians, Bedouins, Sudanese tribesmen and Turks met to share a shisha pipe or two.
Oh, quite nice. Would you like to try it?
Please.
Is it a drug?
No, there is no marijuana on it, don't worry. It's just tobacco. Can you hold it, please?
Okay. And according to guide Mohammed, this souk is still the best place to smoke a shisha this side of Cairo.
I don't get as much smoke coming out of it as you did. Want to try?
Yes.
It's a few years since I smoked one of these.
I'm used to inhaling. Oh.
I think Prue might be confusing a shisha pipe with something else.
I'm rather enjoying it. Can you give me another toke?
Oh, yeah, please.
Fortunately, the souk no longer sells leopard skin rugs or ivory, but spices, there are plenty.
Aswan spice, you know?
Yeah.
This one, many different of hibiscus flower. That one, they call it lemongrass.
Yes.
That one, cinnamon. This one, Egyptian Viagra, call it ginseng.
Ginseng, ginseng.
Ginseng.
Yes, yes, good, we know.
What is it?
This is
ginseng.
My gift for you.
Oh, mm-hmm.
This ginseng. One, you boil it in water.
Yes.
5 minutes, mm-hmm. And then filter and spoon of sugar and drink.
Yes.
At 15 minutes, like a horse. Everything is okay.
Everything like
Welcome.
A horse. Right.
Casanova, man.
Like a horse. We've got to go somewhere.
Okay, fine. We'll have some of that. Beautiful evening.
Very romantic, isn't it? Mm.
Yeah.
I could just imagine being Cleopatra sailing up the Nile in her royal dahabiyah.
Age cannot wither her, nor custom stale her infinite variety.
Thank you.
Moored on the bank of this timeless river, our crew performed the ancient river shanty of the Nile sailors, just as mariners have done for countless generations.
River of life, and tonight it's certainly given us a spring in our step. On the final leg of our 150-mile voyage up the River Nile.
These waters south of Aswan are shallow and rock-strewn, so we've transferred to a river taxi for this slightly more hazardous stretch.
Mind me, why don't we stick to nice, safe canal travel?
There was a canal here once, about 4,000 years ago. It was dug by the Pharaoh to bypass the rapids.
Well, someone should restore it.
Well, it only exists in hieroglyphic writing, so you wouldn't know where to look for it now, I'm afraid.
We're calling in at a vibrant Nubian village. And then it's our final stop at what was once thought of as the source of the Nile.
The last outposts of the ancient Nubian people.
How sad.
Yes.
Very colourful, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
The Nubians are as much a part of the Nile story as their Egyptian neighbours. Living along the riverbank south of Aswan, they are descended from an ancient African civilization that once ruled an empire to rival that of Egypt.
Do you mind if I hold your hand?
No, not at all, no. It's great.
Gahab Sohail is one of a handful of surviving Nubian settlements. The damming of the Nile in 1902 and 1970 led to rising water levels. Entire communities were forced to relocate, and their homes now lie deep beneath the waters of the vast Lake Nasser.
Today, Nubian culture is under great threat.
Welcome to Gharb Sohail.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. We've been invited to the home of Shima and Ahmed, who are determined to keep it alive.
Sharraftuna.
Thank you very much. It's lovely for us to be here. The building of the dam must have made a very big difference to Nubian culture.
Yes. Before Othnopian was just living on the Nile, there was an old fisherman and live in a farmer. But after they built the high dam, they have to go to other place, which is not allow them to fish anymore. So they're starting to change all of their life. For the Nubian people, it was so hard because they always have to live in a freedom, not to live in borders. We always feel special because the Nubian people are starting, or their history starts since maybe 7,000 years or maybe more. Mm-hmm. If we keep as much as we can from our original culture, we will be forever.
Hamid! Hamid!
Hello! Hello!
This is our single. His name, Ahmed.
The culture of the Nubians is not kept in books, but in poems and songs handed down from father to son, mother to daughter, for thousands of years.
Hamid sings of the Nile and of migrating birds. Apt themes indeed for these uprooted river people.
We certainly hope the Nubian people will be here beside the Nile for another 7,000 years.
Now our final port of call, the ancient religious source of the Nile. In a cave deep beneath these islands, the god Hapi is said to have lived, the heel of his foot controlling the flow of the Nile for eternity.
Home to a spectacular temple to the goddess Isis, its visitors are said to include Cleopatra, who claimed to be the living embodiment of the goddess. But the temple, like the Nubians' ancestral homes, also became a victim of the damming of the Nile.
Behind us is the old location of the original island, Philae.
Historian Mohammed Kani tells us how an ingenious rescue operation saved the temple from the rising waters.
When the high dam was built, yes, between 1960 to 1971, yes, the island and the whole temples would be submerged forever. Egypt and UNESCO at that time had to save all these temples.
Yes.
And the only practical idea was moving them to a new location. But in order to do this, they had to build two iron cuff ring dams around. And that's what we see, all these iron bars.
Oh, right, yes.
Fill it between with sand, and then pump out the water, dry the island, recording everything on the island. Then they cut the temples into blocks of stones and move them into the new location.
It's an incredible achievement.
Yes.
It is. It was a big engineering process.
Yes.
The temples were cut into more than 5,000 blocks of stones. And you can imagine that was a big process, like a huge puzzle game, putting it back together.
And so, the last bastion of ancient Egyptian religion rose again. And 2,500 years after it was first built, it once more stands proudly above the waters of the Nile.
Although now it's moved onto a new island, half a mile to the west.
So this is the temple of Isis.
Yes, there's Isis, yes.
Yes, that's Isis on the left, and that's her daughter-in-law, Hathor, on the right. They both dressed the same. So over here on the walls, all these markings of, yeah, black and yellow, that's from the time it was under the water.
Oh, right.
Yes.
Yeah, the yellow was under the mud, and the dark color was exposed to the water.
It was more than Philae's beauty that made it worth saving. It was at this temple that the dying embers of the 4,000-year-old ancient Egyptian culture flickered for one last time and finally went out.
This place over here is, yes, called the Hadrian Gateway. These are the last hieroglyphics written on walls of any Egyptian temple.
Oh.
It dates back to the birthday of Osiris, 394 AD.
And this is the very last example of a graphic language form that had been in existence for how many years?
for more than 4,000 years. These are the last inscriptions.
It's really sad, isn't it?
Yes.
Yes.
It was the end of an ancient way of life. Yet, traveling down this eternal river, I've learned there's still a link between them and us. 4,000 years ago, an Egyptian woman wrote these words.
My hand is in his hand. I wander together with him to every beautiful place. My soul inspired, my heart in bliss, because we go together.
I love the romance of this place. There's a sort of timeless beauty about the Nile, which makes one feel almost part of history.
Yeah.
Next time...
El Barchetto là!
From the Alps to Milan.
Isola Bella.
By a lake.
Magic.
And canal.
You can almost feel you're in the background of a great Renaissance painting.
I never imagined arriving in Milan by canal.
See that same time next week. Tomorrow, a brand new series of Food Unwrapped explores the secrets behind our grub. We're tasting ancient grain bread. Not out of date, promise. Next, fish in the nets, exactly what they need. Don't speak too soon. Pete Wicks encounters a shark in the celebrity island with Bear Grylls.